Okay. We're going to start our next panel as soon as I can find my notes for the next panel. There we go. All right. This panel is composed of representatives from four of the major, I would say, professional organizations in the United States that deal with tax. So our first speaker is going to be Eric L. Green, and he is speaking on behalf of the American Bar Association section of taxation. He's a partner in Green and Sklarz, which is a boutique tax firm with offices in Connecticut and New York. And the focus of his practice is civil and criminal taxpayer representation before the Department of Justice, Tax Division, and the Internal Revenue Service. My next speaker is Troy Lewis, and he is chair of the Tax Executive Committee for the tax section of the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants, the AICPA. And he's testified in this role before the Senate Finance Committee and the House Committee on Small Business. He's been active in the AICPA for over 16 years, and he currently teaches at Brigham Young University. Next, we have Bob Carr, and Bob is the Senior Director of Government Relations of the National Association of Enrolled Agents, and he represents the interests of enrolled agents before the United States Congress and serves as their liaison to the Internal Revenue Service. And I first met Bob when he was working for the IRS, so there you go. And last, but certainly not least, is John Ames. And John is the Executive Vice President and Chief Operating Officer of the National Society of Accountants in Alexandria, Virginia. He has over 40 years of experience in the federal tax arena, with expertise providing legislative and regulatory representation in accounting and federal tax matters to a variety of constituencies. So without further ado, we'll hear from Eric. We'll just have each one of them give their statements, and then I have some questions, and we'll open it up to the floor. So, Eric.
All right, well, Nina, thank you. Thank you, everyone. What I'm going to talk about mostly is what I see as a major concern, which is the impact on taxpayers, particularly in the arena of IRS collection. As you know, many of you know, in 2012, the IRS rolled out its Fresh Start initiative. If you're not aware of this, it's no longer fresh. I hate those stupid late night commercials. But it made some significant progress in the area of collection, but arguably didn't go anywhere near far enough. It expanded the use of streamlined installment agreements for taxpayers so they didn't have to hire professionals and go through the financial analysis. They could simply set up agreements. It expanded the online availability of agreements. It made getting an offer in compromise easier by adjusting the standards that the IRS used. We don't have to go into the technical details at this point. Yet, if you look at the statistics, the ones that were just put out about a month and a half ago in the data book, accounts in IRS collection division inventory have now climbed over 13 million for the first time. Some of that is collection driven, and some of it, to be honest with you, is technology driven. The IRS is simply better at finding non-filers these days. And when folks have not filed for several years, and they file their returns with all the, you know, penalties that go along with it for failure to file, failure to pay an interest, they often will end up in the collection division inventory. We've seen the budget slashed by, I think, $900 million last I checked. And if you listen, one of the big charges against the IRS by Republicans mostly is that it's not a budgetary issue. The IRS could actually fix most of these problems if it just simply had the will to do so. That it's not money, it's the IRS's outlook on this. And though I don't really agree with it, there are some shades of truth to it. One of them, for instance, and which really bothers me, is in the arena of offers and compromise. If you can qualify for an offer, however, you show the ability to full pay over the life of the collection statute, you can't do an offer. This would, in many cases, means having agreements that go 7, 8, sometimes 9 years. And I believe the Advocate, a number of years ago, did a study and found that the average installment agreement defaults at about 48 months. So what we're effectively doing is not taking offers, forcing people back into collection division inventory for long-term installment agreements that we know statistically will default, therefore leading them collection have to pick them up again and chase them again, which is simply a waste of resources, time, and effort. The other thing, and Nina, I apologize, I should have pulled these studies in advance. There was another study that the average offer made was 16 cents on the dollar. Of those that were rejected, ultimately the IRS collected about 7 cents, which means on average, even the bad offers were better than not accepting them. Okay, so when I say shades of truth, I do believe the IRS could take another fresh look at this. I hate, maybe fresh look's not a good, it's a good word to use, but I take a new look at this and reconsider and make more adjustments to their programs. But what bothers me most today is on December 4th, many of you may have heard, President Obama signed the Fixing America's Surface Transportation Act, the FAST Act. And it's 1,300 pages, and I don't recommend any of you go home and read it, but in there are 32 pages that deal with IRS collection, because when we think America's surface transportation, we think IRS collection. And what it does is it does a number of things. The IRS, since I think 2003, has had the ability to use private debt collectors. They did this, again, Nina having looked at this and done a study, the private debt collectors basically robocalled millions of people, collected everyone who could full pay, and then dumped everything else back in the lap of the IRS. Because they don't have the authority to enforce, they don't have the authority to enter installment agreements, they can't consider offers and compromise, and they can't levy or take enforcement action. The FAST Act requires the IRS to use private debt collectors. So starting this fall, we are going to see millions of taxpayer accounts handed over to private debt collectors. And I don't know if former Commissioner Gibbs is still in the room, but what bothers me and what concerns me most about this is we're going to turn over taxpayer information to private debt collectors. When we know identity theft is up 700%, and I'm going to say this delicately, I question the quality of the individuals working at the private debt collection agencies. All right, I said it. You can blame me. But the other thing, if you're not familiar with this, is there are some exceptions to this. The other piece of this, by the way, is not just private debt collection, but the government is going to begin suspending or revoking passports of those individuals that owe seriously delinquent taxes, which is defined as $50,000 or more. And there are some, and by the way, there is some, there are states that do this. Massachusetts and New York, where I practice, does suspend driver's licenses. And it is very effective at getting people to come in and deal with their tax problems. But we'll get to that. But one of my concerns is there are some exceptions to this. If you're in an installment agreement, you have an offer pending, you will have a collection due process hearing, or you have an innocent spouse claim. The one thing not on that list are people who have been deemed uncollectible. And we had a meeting with the Commissioner for Small Business Self-Employed, and she has confirmed that they are going to be turning those people over to private debt collection, and their passports will be suspended or revoked. What concerns me is, one, that there should be some sort of communication out to these people, all right? Communication, they had told me that it would be included in the normal collection message, which means that paragraph that's on the notice would say, we can do things like take your state refund and we can take your federal refund, and buried in there would be suspend your passport. I think that needs to be its own letter, because I think that it's a big enough issue, especially for people who live and work abroad, who will find out the hard way that their passport has been suspended. The other concern I have with this is the only way that the Act allows people to administratively challenge this is to go to court. There is no administrative means of going to the IRS or the State Department to have this fixed. You need to go to federal district court or the United States Tax Court, which now creates a very expensive burden on those who are usually financially challenged. So what I would like to do is I'm here urging the IRS to take another look at its program and build on what it did in 2012 and continue to find ways of working with taxpayers to get this stuff resolved. I also would urge Congress, I'm sure a lot of people are, but they need to tweak this FAST Act to allow administrative means for taxpayers to get these things fixed, and to allow the IRS, truthfully, to, you know, adjust these things for the realities of dealing with taxpayers. And with that, I think I'm at my limit. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, you want to go on?
Sure. Hello, my name is Troy Lewis. On behalf of the American Institute of CPAs, I'd like to thank the National Taxpayer Advocate, Nina Olson, and her office for the opportunity to speak today. The AICPA appreciates the discussion on what taxpayers want or need from the IRS in the future. This is an important issue for our profession. In fact, last May, our governing council passed a resolution focusing on the IRS's need to transform into a modern functioning, evolutionary, and respected federal agency for the 21st century. The question posed here today is, what do taxpayers want or need from the IRS? Most importantly, taxpayers and practitioners must have access, both timely and meaningful access, to the IRS. In order to make this happen, we recommend that the agency focus on three critical things. Number one, utilize modern and secure technology. Two, developing and continuing to hire and train knowledgeable employees. Three, regularly seeking and utilizing stakeholder engagement. We believe the IRS's commitment in these three key areas will have the most impact in providing everyone meaningful access to the IRS. This filing season, I had a personal experience that exemplifies what taxpayers need. A client brought me a standard computer-generated notice the IRS had sent requesting information about capital gain income. The income, which was reported on to the IRS on a Form 1099-B, was properly reported on my client's tax return, and the appropriate amount of income tax had actually been paid. There was no error on the return. However, due to requirements in its matching system, the IRS needed additional information to verify the income was indeed properly reported. The notice was a mere case of matching the third-party information reported to the IRS with information reported on the return. However, it took me 2 letters and 4 months to resolve this notice. It was a highly inefficient experience and an example of where change is clearly needed. You may ask why I just didn't pick up the phone and call the IRS. It's been my experience that the IRS representative, who probably would have answered my call, would not have had the necessary tools or training to resolve the issue. Eventually, after some discussion, the representative revert to the default position of asking me to provide my entire explanation and any related documentation in a letter. It is not efficient for either party if the IRS representative is not able to deal with specific issues over the phone. In today's environment, after mailing the requested information, I still do not have the ability to speak with the representative who specifically assigned this case or someone who even has access to the documentation I submitted. The IRS's current technology does not allow for the sharing of information from one department to another. At best, they can only confirm receipt of the documents. The IRS must have modern and secure technology. In the future, I hope to have multiple options for contacting the IRS, such as calling, sending an email, or having access through a secure online portal. Taxpayers, particularly ones in outlying areas, should have the option of communicating through other methods, such as video chat. When you must rely on old-fashioned letters, interacting with the IRS is a slow process. The IRS should also provide a fully integrated electronic system, such as online accounts similar to what some states use. In the interest of efficiency, the agency should focus on developing and improving practitioner tools, such as online account resolutions and options to submit a power of attorney. With such modern-day options in place, the scenario I described earlier is resolvable within a few days, as opposed to 4 months. Let me close by summarizing a few points. To ensure that we have meaningful access to the IRS, the agency needs to regularly provide a systematic, reliable, and economical source of training to their employees. In order to answer basic questions and to keep up with changing tax laws, IRS representatives need consistent, quality training, comparable to that offered to a tax practitioner. This lack of training often results in poor customer service. Finally, it is critical that the IRS actively pursue stakeholder engagement, particularly on major organizational changes, such as the IRS future state. Stakeholders such as CPAs who are on the front line can provide sound recommendations to ensure the needs of taxpayers, tax practitioners, and the government are met. The AICPA received an initial briefing of the IRS Future State Initiative. While we are encouraged with the overview that was shared with us, we strongly believe continued stakeholder involvement during the decision-making process is essential. We all have a vested interest in the success of the IRS. Furthermore, by empowering the agency with the latest technology, an educated workforce, we will have timely and meaningful access to the IRS, which we believe is the first step in meeting the needs of both taxpayers and practitioners, both today as well as in the future. Thank you for the opportunity to testify, and I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Good morning, Nina. My name is Bob Kerr, and I have the privilege of speaking on behalf of the National Association of Enrolled Agents. Enrolled agents, thank you for the invitation to take part in a public discussion focused on IRS Future State. As the IRS moves forward with online accounts, which are an integral part of its future state, it must include access by those with unrestricted rights to represent taxpayers in order for the strategy to be successful. The agency must find practical methods to authenticate practitioners and to authorize them to solve their clients' problems. A solution that omits practitioners fails to recognize that many taxpayers benefit from representation because they, A, do not want to represent themselves, B, recognize that they are not proficient enough to represent themselves, or C, are afraid to engage with IRS enforcement staff. A portal that faces taxpayers only will place represented taxpayers at a disadvantage, force practitioners to continue to be parked on phone lines, and significantly impede taxpayers' rights to be represented before the agency. We urge the Internal Revenue Service to consider three important policies then. One is to develop robust individual and practitioner online accounts at the same time. The second is to allow Circular 230 practitioners to execute authorizations electronically and to immediately represent those clients. And the third is to allow the use of electronic signatures for all power of attorney and disclosure authorization forms. In order to protect taxpayers' fundamental rights to representation and improve adoption for all groups, IRS should commit to developing a practitioner online account in conjunction with individual taxpayer accounts. The agency should, to the extent possible, phase in similar capabilities across both accounts simultaneously. The states of California and New York are potential models for this approach. Nina, you know the need for this access is not new. For instance, ETAC in its 2014 report outlined capabilities for online accounts for individuals and practitioners. Recognizing resource constraints put on the agency, we urge the service to phase capabilities across practitioners and taxpayer accounts rather than standing up each of those separately. We are deeply concerned IRS will launch an account for individual taxpayers and then fail to follow through with a practitioner account, making it easy for taxpayers to pay balances the agency suggests are due, while making it difficult and expensive for representatives who are mired in a paper and phone process that takes weeks, if not months, to pursue statutorily provided due process rights. And as part of its development efforts for online IRS accounts, IRS should include the ability for taxpayers and Circular 230 tax practitioners to execute and file authorizations electronically so that tax practitioners can immediately represent their clients and or receive information on behalf of those clients. Access to the practitioner online account should be limited for the foreseeable future to trusted individuals known to the agency and fully regulated under Circular 230. The agency may later consider the appropriateness of allowing individuals with limited practice rights to have equally limited access to practitioner accounts. And finally, IRS should move expeditiously to allow electronic signatures for the full family of power of attorney and disclosure authorization forms, that is forms 2848 and 8821. Doing so would speed up considerably the process of resolving taxpayer account problems, saving time and money for both the taxpayer and the service. IRS has laid the groundwork for establishing a universal policy on its electronic signatures with the form 4506T and its IVES, or an Income Verification Express service. The requirements for this widely used form should be adopted across the board for all forms. Electronic signatures provide a convenient option for individual taxpayers and small businesses to comply with our tax system's often complex requirements. Further, electronic signatures identity verification requirements provide a level of security unavailable in ink signatures. IRS's future state is not a state in which one size fits all, and I think we've seen this throughout our remarks today, the remarks we've heard thus far today. Very few of the real challenges in tax administration are answered in such a fashion. Tax administration and taxpayers would benefit tremendously from a real conversation between the agency, which commendably is attempting to look over the horizon and provide reasonable and efficient taxpayer interaction, and practitioners, whose privilege and responsibility it is to represent many of the same taxpayers. We believe the agency must work with Circular 230 practitioner community to break down barriers slowing the agency's move towards online account resolution. Attorneys, EAs, and CPAs are known and trusted professionals on whom IRS may reasonably rely to move forward its vision to improve tax administration and taxpayer service online. This concludes my prepared remarks.
Thank you. John?
Thank you, Nina, and thank you for holding this forum. I think I've certainly learned something this morning, and I'm sure everyone else in the audience has as well. I'm here representing the National Society of Accountants, and I have had a chance to review the Taxpayer Advocate's 2015 annual report, and you have helpfully in that report included and summarized the seven themes of the IRS future state. I recall that when this initiative was announced by Commissioner Koskinen, he stated that the idea is that taxpayers would have an account at the IRS where they would, they or their preparers would be able to log in securely, get all of the information about their account, and interact with the IRS as needed. For many taxpayers and their preparers, that interaction is many times just a matter of going online to file a return or find information about general issues or see about their specific tax return information. It seems clear, however, that the current state of IRS technology is hindering this interaction. For example, some IRS forms still cannot be submitted online, which requires that the entire return has to be submitted via regular mail. And as we know, if you're looking for a refund, the IRS tells you, if you submit a return via mail, your refund can be 6 or 7 or 8 weeks delayed. Computer-generated IRS form letters often include a date by which a taxpayer response must be received to forestall the placement of IRS liens. Since the IRS cannot currently receive responses via email, this means the taxpayer must, again, resort to the regular mails. However, the IRS does not have the capability to quickly open taxpayer mail, with the result that the IRS may place a lien on taxpayer assets even if the taxpayer's timely filed response is sitting unopened somewhere in an IRS mail facility. IRS personnel often cannot quickly locate taxpayer forms, records, powers of attorney, or other documents when taxpayers or preparers do manage to reach an employee, meaning that the 45-minute or more often 2-hour telephone waiting time is wasted. On the other hand, we have the benefit of a courtesy disconnect and finding out what that's all about. According to the commissioner, the IRS operates more than 35 different computer systems, most of which cannot communicate with one another, meaning that technology-related barriers to the resolution of taxpayer problems still exist and seem to be multiplying. NSA agrees with remarks of others who have stated that the IRS future state should allow taxpayers to, quote, effectively and securely interact with their tax administrator in the way that they want to be served, end quote. What that means, as we've heard this morning, is that it means different things to different people. Low-income folks do not have broadband. Some people who do have broadband are perfectly willing to email with their grandchildren or others, but they'll be darned if they're going to do any commerce online because, by golly, that's where the scamsters are. Still others, you know, still believe, apparently, that the internet is a fad and will go away in time. For all of the taxpayers, though, whether it's low-income taxpayers and others, those who do have technology access, what we look forward to is an IRS future state where, for example, you can submit a Form 2868 power of attorney and have immediate access to a client's information. This is something that has already been mentioned this morning. Or a taxpayer should be able to submit an inquiry on an IRS correspondence similar to what was capable on the EAR system. Or, how about a simple one, submit a Form 1040X as an e-filed return rather than having to mail it in. Or have a chat capability. If you're online on your account, we've all been online with a bank, and a chat capability comes up. Do you want to chat with someone? And as I've discussed with others previously here today, one chat responder can handle up to nine individuals at one time. So there's a multiplier effect. So technology improvements, we think, are only part of our vision of a future state. We agree with other commenters that the need for face-to-face, voice-to-voice communication and interaction will continue to be necessary regardless of the wide array and quality of the digital tools developed and offered by the IRS. The range of necessary explanations and problem resolution will always require someone knowledgeable at the IRS. Excuse me. I wanted to conclude my remarks by focusing on the IRS budget and the fact that all of these technology changes that we have proposed and discussed will require an adequate IRS budget. That seems very clear, and it seems clear apparently by the day. But what I want to do instead is focus on or respond to a question that you asked, Nina, about this GET transcript application that is being rolled out apparently as we speak. Bob and I both attended a meeting where the IRS folks in charge of it told us that they expected 30% of the people to actually get through. These are not people who do not have broadband or do not have the capability of even trying. These are people who actually have the technological capability. But the IRS said, you know, we expect 30% to get through, meaning a 70% failure rate. And I remember talking with Bob, and we said, well, you know, does that mean 65% will be a resounding success? What is the standard by which we measure success in that arena? It seems obviously different things to different people. I would think that success would have a somewhat higher percentage than 30%. But let me stop there. Again, thank you for having the hearing, and we'll go to questions, I guess.
Well, that's a great lead into some of my questions and comments, because I'm going to exercise my authority as the host to make some comments, too, you know. But to go to the online account, so all of you know, what will be in the online account that they're creating is not just the GET transcript, but also the IP PIN replacement device application that they had to take out. And even more interestingly, the online installment agreement will be put in through the online account. And that has implications then for international taxpayers who today could just go onto the IRS.gov and enter into an installment agreement online, but now you will have to do it through the online account. I myself do not know of too many identity thieves that have been trying to pose as someone else and make payments to the IRS. So I'm not sure what the rationale is for putting the installment agreement behind, other than to protect any access, you know, any way of getting into our system, period. So there may be real reasons for that. And to the point about the 30% success rate, that is what I've heard from the commissioner. And in my own head, I think that's even optimistic based on some of the populations I've been thinking about. But I think it points to the tension between the need to really protect the IRS database and the data that we have, which is an incredibly valuable asset, and which mandates high security and you know, difficult authentication, if you will, versus getting people to be able to do things online. And I'm not suggesting that the IRS relax its security requirements, but I am saying you need to have truth in advertising. You then need to tell people that only 30% optimistically will be able to open an online account, and not design your future state around everybody in the world, like Jane, the middle school teacher, being able to open an online account, not to mention Larry, the service worker, or you know, whomever, or your mother-in-law who happens to be on your cell phone account, your you know, family plan, but doesn't live with you, because she won't be able to open it, nor will your adult children who are on your phone account. So I want to start with pursuing some questions, and I'm so glad to have you all up here, because I really want to get into the nuts and bolts of what an account would be, what you think would be important to have in this online account, and what you would want taxpayers, to your potential clients, to be able to do, and some of the taxpayer rights implications of this. And before I go further on that, I do want to address Eric's, and this is just some background information. He raised the issue about the passports and not exempting persons who the IRS has determined to be currently not collectible because of hardship, because if we collected any money from them, we would by law have to give that money back, because they are experiencing economic hardship and they cannot meet their basic living expenses. That is also true for the private debt collectors, that where the IRS has already determined that these taxpayers cannot pay their basic living expenses and are experiencing economic hardship, there is no exception for keeping them from going out to the private debt collectors under the law. These accounts will have to go out if they've been inactive for over a year or something like that, and by definition they would be. And that has particular consequences in the Federal Payment Levy Program, which is an automated levy of Social Security benefits. We worked for years to get the IRS to exclude persons who are at 250% federal poverty level, which is basically the statutory definition under low-income taxpayer clinics for low income. And we showed that that poverty level meant, by and large, we showed in a study we did, TASS did, that that poverty level basically meant that you were experiencing economic hardship. And the IRS agreed, and they excluded taxpayers with those income levels from the Federal Payment Levy Program for levying Social Security and all sorts of other federally issued payments. 2 years ago, or a year and a half ago, we were able to get the IRS to exclude persons who receive Social Security disability from the Federal Payment Levy source, you know, from the federal, so we weren't levying on disability payments against persons who were determined by Social Security to be disabled. Both of those categories of taxpayers will go out to the private debt collectors under the law, unless we can figure out some way within the legal framework to exclude them. And so I just want to, you know, let everybody know that that's happening, so you can work those issues.
Part of the problem, in the IRS's defense, the IRS did not ask for this.
Right.
Congress just did it, and clearly didn't discuss it with anybody. And so, you know, I just want to make it clear that it's not the IRS dreamt this up.
It's a revenue raiser. That it allowed a lot of other things to be passed. Okay, so I want to sort of talk about this online account. So what sort of things do you all as representatives need, what do you think an online account would do? How would it help you in your representation of your clients? And when would you need to pick up the phone and talk to the IRS or communicate with the IRS in some other means? And maybe we can just start and go down the line.
Well, given what I do, I tend to see people who are not filers or have come in and, as I mentioned with offers, you know, if they can full pay under the statute. So for me, I need to pull transcripts, and very often I need wage and earning reports. Sometimes you can get through on hold and have them faxed. That can take depending on what time of year, can take 15 minutes to several hours. I have software that actually does this, but the POA must be on file for, you know, and it's taking now 5 to 10 days. And by the way, I don't know if anyone else has experienced this, every POA I send in, regardless, comes back because they claim it's not signed or not dated, and it is. So I don't know what's going on at the CAF unit, but if I can find someone who works there, I have a lot to say to them. There's no phone number, lucky for them. Anyway, it's very frustrating. And by the way, the client gets the same letter, and the client starts calling saying, don't you know what you're doing? I hired you. And it's very hard to explain, no, the government is screwed up. But, you know, because everyone believes the IRS is all-knowing and all-seeing. And we know they're not. But for me, today I'm going to leave here. I'm going to go to the airport because I am TSA pre-checked. I'm going to walk through security. They're not going to make me take anything out of my bag. And I'm going to get on a plane. I don't see why I couldn't, as a practitioner, and I'll pay a fee. I paid $85 or whatever for TSA. That I can be pre-approved so that I can go on and say, yes, I have a 2848, scan up a copy, and get instant access to taxpayers to move their case along. Because it's either spending hours on the phone or waiting days on end for it to go on file.
Okay.
It's a great question. What do those accounts look like? I think, first of all, you have to take one step back, though, and say, does one size really fit all? And the answer is no. So I envision an account that provides a lot of robust information for those that choose and have access, but it's not exclusive. It's only one element. Just like today's financial institutions, you can bank several ways. And we need to recognize that we're going to have taxpayers that are going to choose for various reasons, some which we've heard and some that you can speculate. It's going to be different. So in my mind, the kinds of things that I envision that the account would provide are would be the types of information that we're now spending endless hours waiting on phone trying to talk to somebody about. Things such as payment history, their filing history, what have you shown. The IP PIN is interesting because we have so many troubles going through the front door now. Maybe a different portal would be better. Getting transcripts. And then the audit history, we spend a lot of time going back and forth with that. What have you received? What do we show? Is this still open? Have you received this? I think a lot of those types of answers could be done in a secure way. But I would also caution, obviously, anyone that's been around here or has worked for the government is fully aware of the OPM issues last summer. That, as you said, Nina, this is the government's database is of the highest importance, and it needs to be protected. So I think we need to measure twice, cut once. We need to be very careful as we open up that portal. It ought not to be rushed to market. But done in a specific, deliberate way, well-studied, I think we can provide better value than what we're doing now.
If I can just respond to that for a second, you know, one of the things that I'm hoping people don't assume is that just creating an online portal will solve all the IT problems that the IRS has. As of this morning, most IRS systems were down and have been down since overnight. So if you were not here on this platform, but you were calling to get information from a customer service representative or your case advocate in Taxpayer Advocate Service, we would not be able to give you any information because we can't get into our own databases. As well, it's not clear to me if the IRS has between 60 to 200 case management systems, depending on who you speak to on whatever given day, whether the online account is going to link to all of those. So when you say it would be nice to see audit information and audit history, the systems don't retain a lot of notices. We will have to reprogram the systems to retain the actual notice that the taxpayer was sent, so you as a practitioner would be able to see that notice and get a robust informational history. So there's so much work that needs to be done to make just what you're describing as an online account work. So Bob, you know, if you want to pick up from there.
Thanks, Nina. I think I'd start by suggesting let's make sure that IRS isn't building us a Procrustean bed here. Because one size doesn't fit all. And the fundamental piece is to start with access. And IRS needs to build access that works for taxpayers. And IRS needs to build access that works for practitioners. And I use the term practitioners intentionally because to me there's a distinction between practitioners and preparers. I don't want anyone here to think that those are, to me, fungible words because they aren't. I think also this approach raises some significant and fundamental taxpayer rights issues. Let's start with Pub 1. How are taxpayers going to even know of their right to representation? You'll have to excuse me for being, I suppose, a little Johnny One Note on this. I suppose there are 9 or 10 taxpayer Bill of Rights pieces, but I just keep going back to the right to representation. But, you know, I'm sitting here on behalf of the enrolled agents, and that's what we do. So let's, I just take my moment here to strongly encourage that and to recognize that there are taxpayers certainly who are going to want to help themselves, and that's fine. We don't begrudge that in any way. But as I indicated in our prepared remarks, there are taxpayers for a number of reasons don't want to do that or can't do that or don't believe that they are up to the task. And at the end of the day, I think IRS needs to remember that tax administration system, in fact, works better when educated and informed IRS enforcement staff are working with educated and informed representatives.
So maybe, John, before you talk, I'll throw this out, and you can maybe also weave that into your answer, because this goes to what Bob just said. So much of what's going on in the online account is viewed in the pre-refund environment. So if you file a return and there's an issue with it, you left off a notice, you left off a W-1099, or maybe, as in the vignette with Jane, we think we've run you through the dependent database and we think you're not eligible for it. This is all happening in pre-refund. So if the taxpayer's probably not going to be with a representative at that point, a practitioner, as you say, Bob. So you're going to have these taxpayers, if they sign on to an online account, agreeing to things that will have lots of consequences going forward, that will become a self-assessed, you know, liability. And then when you go in to say, well, that was wrong, well, the IRS will say, well, the taxpayer agreed to that. So if you disagree, you will not get the right to an appeal because it's pre-refund. The next thing you'll get is a notice of deficiency. So I'd like you to, you know, I mean, you can all comment, but I'm throwing that out to John and then anybody who wants to.
Well, this is, we've all gone online and, you know, every time there's a new app or something that you download, you have to agree to the, you know, 78 pages of legalese and
say that you read them too.
Oh, absolutely, and you know, forget understanding them, but that is going to be a problem, especially if you're talking about not uneducated but undereducated for that purpose kind of a taxpayer. They're signing away rights that that are on page 45 that they have no idea what it is, and this assumes that they know what their rights are before they even start down that path, which is not an assumption I'm willing to make. I had mentioned in the written remarks that the IRS has so many different computer systems, and none of them talk with one another. And yet, as Eric mentioned, if you're representing a taxpayer, you want the complete picture. You want the audit. You want the transcript. You want everything you can get hold of. It's part of due diligence, knowing what it is you're talking about. If you're a Circular 230 preparer, you're required to get that kind of background. And yet, there doesn't seem to be a capability of really of doing that. And my fear is that a lot of this information is on those separate systems that don't talk to one another. So, ideally, the account that was created under the system would be able to draw in all of those disparate systems and communicate with them and get the information that you really need in order to do a good job for the taxpayer.
Anybody else want to weigh in on this? So another technical issue I wanted to throw out, which I think is very important, and I haven't been successful in getting the IRS position changed is the application of the timely mailed, timely filed rule in a digital environment. If we're pushing people to online accounts, and so they send an email, and let's say the IRS, like today, the IRS server is down, and it's an election on a given day. The IRS position right now is it's not the date of the email that you can show on your email that you sent it, but the date that it receives it, which is its position about faxes. When I talked to Chief Counsel about applying the timely faxed, timely filed rule, they say, no, because you can alter fax machines just like you can alter postage meters, you know, like the cover sheet, and that's why we require certified mail, you know, et cetera, or mailing service, you know, post FedEx, et cetera, to get availability of the timely mailed, timely filed rule. And to me, if your future state is built on digital, well, I don't know, I should ask each one of you, would any of you, where something really matters, then if the only way to prove timely mailing is to send certified mail, return receipt, how would you proceed?
Generally, I like the fax because I get the fax confirmation back.
But it won't confirm it.
That's not going to confirm it. And by the way, I've had issues where I have, because a lot of them have e-faxes now, I'm not getting the confirmation. And so, we have e-fax, so now I can send it from email, although I suppose I could alter that.
Position is the only way to have the date of your mailing or sending count as the date of IRS receipt is to send it certified mail, return receipt, or using one of the overnight delivery services that they have outlined. That's the only way.
It seems, Nina, that what they're looking for is third-party validation of a particular date, so that as a taxpayer do not have the opportunity to change the date, to backdate it, that kind of thing. So it seems that what you're really looking for is, can you do it through software? Can you do it by sending such a form to a secure email address or somehow that, the basic function of it is just to verify the receipt.
And if you can't get that in any way other than certified mail or these overnight services, are you going to go to hard copies and send it?
I have.
What I do.
Yeah.
Right.
If I fax it,
you have no other option.
Back, or if it were online, if you see it post, I would probably rely on that. But
right.
But in the instances where I've had it not, once someone in my office is running to the post office, hopefully not me.
Right.
But
if
it matters.
If it matters, if there's a lot of zeros involved and the first number's not a one, if it really matters,
right,
you're gonna do whatever you want to, the proverbial belts and suspenders, whatever. Yeah, absolutely. That's what you
right.
do. It's practical. I mean,
right.
The issue you've outlined is you're giving us an archaic rule sort of based in the 1980s and 1990s.
Right.
But
right.
not recognizing that we're a little bit beyond that.
Right.
So to your point, in a future state, you'd have to recognize not only embracing the technology, but embracing all that the technology can produce.
Right.
There can be better ways to do it. But yeah, if we truly want to get out of the paper business as it is, we would have to embrace something like that, because if it comes to proof of mailing on an S election, I mean something that just time it matters. There's no alternative. You would definitely paper file.
Well, and the service for years and years has been pushing electronic commerce, take two e-files and call me in the morning kind of thing. But what ends up happening is that the agency does so because it's convenient for the agency. It's expeditious for the agency, not because it's convenient or expeditious for anyone else. And at the end of the day, we can build systems that are 99.9999% up. So it's not that we can't do that. And so if the service is going to require us, is going to build this brave new world where we communicate electronically, then I would suggest that it's incumbent on the service to build something that doesn't go down. It's not undoable. It's more expensive, and there is a difference between 99.99 versus 99. And the tech people know all this because it devolves into number of minutes per year that you're down. And so if you can build a system that's down for an acceptable number of minutes a year, then you've solved the problem. And then we're not running to FedEx or wherever to do this. And again, as my colleagues have suggested, but why are we using 1956 technology to work in this environment? Well, fax machines for that matter and the CAF,
right.
But that's a separate issue.
And it seems that years ago, I'm sure the IRS looked at fax machines and said, well, who would accept that stuff? Who knows where that's coming from? So we've been apparently able to overcome that particular hurdle. Let's get that done as well.
By the way, this works both ways. I would like to have an online account so I don't get 50 pieces, 50 letters every day, and we have letter opening parties over coffee every morning with, for each, period of payroll tax debt, let's say, for 3 years on the same taxpayer. If I could go into an online account as the POA and have that stuff electronically, how much would the IRS save in postage?
So you would want to be able, to go into an online account and then be able to say, don't send me letters, just send me an email notifying. You could turn it off, and that would be important. You would have that option. It wouldn't be mandated because some may want it, but you'd, okay.
More to the point, I'd like, my members to be able to tell their clients, you turn that off because, as we both know, you get a month's worth of IRS letters and you give them to me in a box at the end of the month, unopened.
So, well, that actually raises another issue. So I think I've heard from most of you that the online account should be available to practitioners. Mm-hmm. But if you look at what the IRS is thinking about doing with the online account, particularly in the pre-refund environment, that you're going to do math error through the, you can agree, as Jane does, agree on a math error case, in the pre-filing environment to having her return adjusted. The vast majority of taxpayers, individual taxpayers in the United States, go to unregulated return preparers. Just the numbers are there. So for the online, it seems to me that for the online account to make economic sense, there's going to be a lot of pressure on the IRS to open it up to unregulated return preparers. And so if an unregulated return preparer, some of the ones that are doing some of the scams with people, can say to the client, you can turn this off and I'll just get the notices. We've all seen how that works with the payroll service providers that have embezzled money or gone under. So I'd like to hear from you all about the risks of, of expanding the online account to the unregulated return preparer population. And if you have to do it, what sort of precautions would you put in place?
I'm wondering if there isn't going to be a way to dovetail this with the fallout from Loving, because you keep hearing Congress is going to do something. Where I'm going with this is, will the IRS actually be able to regulate those people and bring them in? And as part of it, I would be very leery of taking it outside of Circular 230 professionals. That said, Nina, you hit, a lot of people do go to for lack of a term, unlicensed practitioners. Theoretically, I would allow taxpayers to do this for themselves. They have every right to do that. Whether it's advisable or not is immaterial. They have the right to handle their own audit if they want, their own collection case. I don't know that I would allow non-Circular 230 professionals. And if the taxpayer wants to share their information with their unauthorized professional, I guess that, again, that's their choice.
Right.
Nina, we've been, the enrolled agents in NAEA for years and years, as you're aware, been on this issue of minimum standards for return preparers. But I think it's important that we stop pretending that there's no difference between Circular 230 practitioners and the rest of the world. We can look at the world as we'd like it to be, or we can look at the world as it is today, and let's look at it that as it is today just for the moment. We've also been on record for years and years as during every overhaul of Circular 230, asking IRS to remove limited practice. So let's build the system then that says if you can go, as a taxpayer, you can go to whoever you want. But if you need your preparer to be a practitioner, again, making the difference between those terms, then you need to get a practitioner. And the agency has a great ability, has a great bullhorn in order to suggest to the world that there is a difference. And I think that that's grossly underutilized, and certainly grossly underutilized when it comes to enrolled agents.
I think one of the key points here is that with the Circular 230 preparers, there's already a regulatory regime that exists. I'd simply suggest you utilize what's there. There is a higher standard. There is a difference. There's professional standards that they subscribe to. There's a P10 regime. There are other regimes that already exist. So rather than layering on something, there is a distinct difference regulatorily. I do have concerns if we were to open it up for the various things you said, Nina. There are risks. The unscrupulous preparers are out there. As most of us know, those folks that are out doing these kinds of things come in all shapes and sizes, but if you want to demographically look at them, they don't look like a Circular 230 preparer. So I think there's some merit with that. One of the elements you said, what are some of the elements? I think the taxpayer has to have control of that account. I think that's crucial. I don't think it's in the taxpayer's best interest to be able to easily turn on and off things unless they choose to do so. But the same things we've learned with the paper world in which we've lived, we need to learn from that historically and recognize that all that happens with electronic is they just speed it up.
I think that's actually, I've been trying to say to people, you know, you have to have people behind this online account answering your emails or writing your emails, you know, and unless one of our witnesses in Red Oak actually said, before you start building this online system, you might want to get your customer service in shape and your people trained and your correspondence clear, because otherwise all you'll do is just send us incomprehensible letters faster.
Mm-hmm. Progress.
Which is not progress, exactly. I don't know whether anybody else wants to respond.
Let me add on, and you know, everyone was talking about Circular 230 preparers, and yet every time OPR sends out its list of disciplinary actions, the only people on there are Circular 230 preparers. So it's not like they're pure as the driven snow either, but we have their names, we know who they are, and that's really the important point. So whether you're talking about, Circular 230 preparers, as we have referred to them, or unlicensed preparers, or people who may have maybe Oregon preparers, and they pass an exam but aren't EAs or whatever, we know who they are. For that reason, one of the reasons I like the AFSP program, because it allows those whose practice does not require them to be a CPA or an attorney or EA, mm-hmm. it allows them to subscribe to the same standards and hopefully be subject to the same discipline. And as long as we know who they are,
right.
Not with respect to representation, limited representation only. I think as long as we know who they are and they agree to be subject to Circular 230, agree to receive education on an annual basis, I think that would give us at least some measure of security.
So before I open this up to the floor, I thought I would close with something that Eric had raised, which was the discussion about offers and compromise. On April 14th, Small Business Self-Employed issued a memorandum, some interim guidance, that said that they were changing their normal processes for offers. That they, heretofore, when someone submitted an offer and compromise with the user fee and the 20% down, the IRS would accept the return and the offer, go through and see whether there were any tax returns due that were outstanding. And if there were, they would send a letter to the taxpayer saying, we're holding your offer, we're holding the money, and you have 45 days to file your returns. On April 14th, citing resources among other reasons, and I haven't figured out why that, the new guidance for offers being submitted with a 20% down payment and a user fee, but the IRS finds there are some outstanding returns, is to return the offer, return the user fee, and return the 20% down. So we do know that about 70% of the offers before this guidance who needed to have returns filed actually did, the taxpayers did file their returns and the offers went processed. So it seems to me that under the guise of resources, the IRS is returning money that we have in our little hands. And I'm just wondering how you think your clients would respond to that.
Well, hopefully, if the representative, again, this, if they're represented, the representative should have pulled and seen if they have outstanding returns. It used to be 6 years, but I think I just read now it's for all years. They've now changed their mind, which, by the way, makes it even more fun, because the clients that come in that haven't filed in 10 years generally didn't file and they have no records. So it just makes it loads of fun. I don't follow the logic either. We have it in hand. I would give the 45 days where we're keeping the money and you can try again.
It's an incentive, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's one of these things, as a CPA, I always put myself in a business perspective, and I recognize full out that it's an agency and it's different. But nevertheless, you know, when you read about only 1/3 of the calls getting answered for installment sales agreements, these are people trying to give you money.
Right.
Right? If this were a business, you would stop whatever you were doing and take their money gladly and then sort out the details, right? So I think there's an element of that as they look to future state that we have to prioritize a little bit about on the customer service side, but also have a fiscal mind. You would think that naturally, just debits equaling credits, as it were, that money came in, you would immediately cash it and then start the process of evaluating, rather than saying, we're just gonna hold it, or worse yet, we're gonna send it back and we'll think about it.
Anybody else wanna weigh in on that?
I'd echo the comments from earlier, one of which is that, you know, there is a difference between being represented and not being represented. And so I could see a world in which those who are not represented, not understanding the rules very well, but those who are represented, it sort of borders on malpractice to send an offer in which the taxpayer has open ears. To your opening remarks, is why would the IRS send back money in hand when part of its job is to collect, you know, increase voluntary compliance? I think I wonder what kind of research the agency did on this, because it would be in this odd position then of holding on to the 20% and not receiving those returns, that the outstanding returns, which you're well aware is quite possible. And then it gets beaten over the head for taking 20% out of people who don't have any money and who didn't follow the rules. And so maybe that's the thing they're I don't know, but again, those are unrepresented, so I have a hard time getting there.
Yeah, I think that's a valid dichotomy. Those who was representatives submit it, and those who do it, you know, for themselves. A representative who did that without knowing the open returns, I agree with Bob that there's an element of malpractice there. You really should know that.
You know, for the unrepresented, it would seem to me in particular, if you've got somebody coming in giving you money, you would want to work with that person, not send something back, but work with them. They probably don't know. They don't know how to get the information to prepare the returns. You know, they may need to go to a VITA site that's open all year round to do those returns, since the IRS is no longer doing, you know, return preparation in the walk-in sites. You know, that sort of thing. And that if you've got that engagement from a taxpayer, you should milk that, particularly an unrepresented taxpayer, you should milk that for all it's worth.
And let's not forget that just because you've paid someone to do your offer doesn't mean that you're using a practitioner.
Exactly.
Again, going back to real distinction between a preparer and a practitioner,
right.
Nina.
Right. Good point. So let's open this up for anyone who wants to make a comment. We're here for the public forum, so we'd love to hear from you. And if you just go to a microphone, I'd appreciate that. Or the microphone will come to you. Maybe.
Hello. This thing is on, I see. I am an attorney. I am capable and able to hire CPAs, which I have. But I'm here because I'm familiar with some of the numbers about people, low-income people and others, who cannot afford help from various tax practitioners. And one of their major problems is that there is a lack of paper return information, including the return documents themselves, from the IRS. Figures I've seen indicate 46 million taxpayers filed paper returns last year, and the IRS does not provide paper returns even to those people for this year, for example.
Mm-hmm. You mean the forms? The forms, yes.
And I think it's a major unexplored, it was referred to in the first panel several times, but the lack of ability of low-income and disabled people and others to use and work computers and that kind of thing is a major problem which needs to be addressed by the IRS.
Well, you know, I every year in preparing my own return like to get a paper copy of the 1040 instructions. And before this filing season, I was able to walk into my place of business, namely here, the main IRS headquarters, and pick up a copy of the 1040. And I thought that was much wiser because it was printed with soy ink and it was on thinner recycled paper than anything I could print out on my laser printer at home with thicker paper and more trees killed. And lo and behold, the IRS was not stocking paper forms in the headquarters of the IRS, so I couldn't get my copy of the 1040 from them. We have heard a lot of complaints from taxpayers and walk-in sites all over the United States that forms have run out in the on the shelves and the stacks at the walk-in sites, the paper forms. And the IRS's position has been, well, what's causing the problem is that those stacks are empty, so we're going to remove the stacks, and that will solve the problem. I'm very concerned about this because I do believe we should go where what the taxpayers are saying they need, and there is a group of taxpayers who are saying that they need paper forms, that they want paper forms, and I don't know why we would get into an argument with taxpayers about that.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay, does anybody on the panel want to make a closing comment?
Just wanted to thank you for holding this. Again, I learned a lot tonight. Thank you.
The only thing I would like to say is what you're doing right now is exactly what I would hope for the future state.
Right.
These people that you're hearing from up here, the Circular 230 folks, they're on the front lines. They see what's happening. They have a direct connection to the taxpayer themselves. And with that relationship, I think we can bring information back in a way that can be helpful. But I think the key is to do it as we go along, as we're developing it, rather than develop it and say, hey, what do you think of this? Rather, why don't we talk about what your needs are now so that as we develop it, we can do it the right way.
No, thank you,
Nina,
for having me.
I'm sorry, Eric. The service, and you've been here for a while as well, we still remember the days of Commissioner Rosati, who famously said, let's be an agency that consults and then decides, rather than decides and then explains. And you suggested in your recent report to Congress that IRS has built its future state and done so without a whole lot, or in fact without any input from its partners, although the agency at the same time professes to value its partners. And so let's value partners in a way that partners would like to be valued, which is being part of the process, as opposed to just getting the end result and saying, here, hope you like it, or love it or leave it.
Okay, well, I want to thank this excellent panel and our panel this morning. If you want to stay inside this building for lunch, just meet with the folks and my folks outside. Otherwise, we'll be back at 2 where we have our fascinating final panel, which is really looking at basically a lot of issues about being online from some non-tax folks. Okay, thank you very much, all.
Thanks.
That was wonderful.